For your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Well, good morning, St. Barnabas.
Good morning.
Good morning, everyone. We are so grateful that you have chosen to spend your morning here. Thank you so much. My name is Alyssa Lothar, and I serve as one of the associate pastors here.
And my name is Kissa, Vaughn. I serve as senior pastor here at St. Barnabas.
And I am Jim Goodwin. I also serve as associate pastor. Hey, in the pew in front of you, for those that are visiting with us today, you'll find a connect card. Take a moment, fill that out, drop it in the plate as it comes by later. For those of you that are on the front row, you'll have to depend upon the kindness of those behind you. You'll also find a prayer card in the pews as well. If you have a specific thing that you would like us to pray about for you, fill that out, also drop that in the plate. These are great ways to get connected with the life of our church here.
We have an awesome new ministry that we are just starting called Sleep in Heavenly Peace. At Christmas time, we challenged you to give a special gift. We raised way more money than we were expecting. We were hoping to build 10 beds, and we're going to build 60 beds instead. Super exciting. This ministry helps us build beds for kids right here in Arlington who don't have a bed to sleep in at nighttime. And we want to make a difference in their learning by helping them have a great place to sleep. If you're willing, if you would love to come and help us build beds, it's May the 4th be with you.
And also with you.
There you go. That's going to be our build day. Kids as young as 5 years old, as long as they have a grown-up with them, can come help us build. And every skill level is needed. So you are completely qualified. So if you're interested in coming to help us build beds, there's a way for you to sign up. And we'll talk about that right at the end of our announcement time. So
yes.
And you don't have to be a member of the church. Just come help us build some beds.
Yes. So. Well, we're also excited. Last week we got to announce the theme for Vacation Bible School is a camping theme. It's going to be wonderful. So if you have camping gear, know that I'm going to be talking to you because we're going to decorate the whole church. So Vacation Bible School is going to be June 24th through the 27th. It's for kids that are pre-K through 6th grade. If you have a kid younger than that you want to participate, you can come volunteer. We have teacher tots, and we will take everyone who wants to help. Also, our youth show up for that, amazingly so. If you're in 7th grade or older, 7th grade through senior in high school, we normally have about 40 youth that come and help volunteer for this. So we would love for you guys to sign up. The QR code was up on the screen, but we'll also show you how to do that in just a little bit.
Awesome. A little closer, April 13th is our game night. It's a great time for us to gather around the table and have a time of fellowship. Bring a snack to share. If you are a competitive gamer, sit at Kissa's table.
Okay.
She will play to win. Absolutely. If you're not competitive and just want to have a good time, sit at any of the other tables.
Who does that?
Me. I do that.
Okay.
And that's coming up at 6 o'clock on the 13th.
We want to say a special welcome to all of our EEC families. We're so glad that you guys are here. If you have a kiddo, one of your older siblings, and they want a color or something like that, Caitlin is in the back, and there's some clipboards. We don't have a whole ton of them, but we have enough that if you want to do that during the service, those are back there for you to grab. And speaking of Caitlin is our youth director, and she is taking our youth on a mission trip this summer. They're going to Denison, and she needs 3 adults to go with her to make this all happen. So if you are one that likes to work with youth, or you just really want to help, she will teach you, she will guide you, and we could definitely use the help.
Yes, she has definitely stressed that there is no experience required.
Not any.
Yeah, it's a life-changing experience. If you've never been on a mission trip, we would love for you to be a part of our youth mission trip this summer. So as some of you know that as United Methodist pastors, we are appointed by our bishop to serve in the church in which we are serving. And we got word this week that Alyssa has been officially appointed as our associate pastor for the next 2 years.
Yay.
Alyssa has been in the process of ordination to become a full elder. This is the kind of the beginning step. She'll serve a 2-year residency here with us and then be fully ordained as an elder in our church. So it was exciting news. It's been a long journey, and so we get to celebrate with her. So 7 years, it's been a long journey. Anyway, but she's really close, so we're excited to announce her appointment.
Amazing.
Yay. Want to pray for us into worship?
Yes, please. Let's go to God as we prepare our hearts for worship. Most gracious Heavenly Father, we welcome you here in this space this morning. May the words that we hear bring a message of hope. May our gathering together bring us closer just to you and just to each other. God, we are so blessed to be here in this place. We ask all of this in the name of and for the sake of the risen Christ. Amen.
Amen.
this beautiful day. What a beautiful day, everybody. Some of y'all know that I've spent 15 years as head director over at Martin, and so I've been out judging UIL contests near Pearland all week, and I ran into a challenge with a step and hit the sidewalk really hard. I always wondered what it'd be like to be hit in the face. So anyway, I just appreciate y'all being here. I love how full and energized we are with all the young folks. Good morning, and if you're able, please stand for our call to worship. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Don't rely on your own understanding.
It is hard to trust so much is unknown, when we can't see the next steps, when the way is clear.
All things are possible for the one who has faith.
It is hard to have faith when religion seems like empty promises, when prayers seem unheard, when there is no answer for desire.
Happy are those who find trust and wisdom, who have faith and seek understanding.
Lord, we believe. Help our unbelief. Amen.
For our affirmation of faith. Heaven and earth declare God's glory. The sky proclaims the work of God's hands. Day and night bear witness to the Creator. They speak without words to all who are wise. Lord our God, how majestic is your name throughout the earth. Your glory is higher than the heavens. When we look up at the sky, what your fingers made, the sun and moon and stars in the second place. What are human beings that you think of them? What are human beings that you pay attention to them? Yet you've made us only slightly less than divine. You've given us wisdom and understanding. You've given us your instruction and a capacity for faith. You bless us with the ability to know you and trust you. Your instruction is perfect, and your commandments are wise. How majestic is your name throughout the earth. Amen. Be seated.
Well, good morning again. And as we gather as Christians in God's house this morning, one of the things that we often do is we pray. And so this is our pastoral prayer, and at the end, I will lead us into the Lord's Prayer, and those words will be on the screen. Join me in prayer this morning. Creator God, we come before you this day, gathered here in your house, looking for direction in our lives and wanting to make a sense of all that we see around us. Many of us come here because we are broken, some physically, some emotionally, some spiritually, and we seek your healing touch, God. We live in a world that is full of violence and hatred, and we ask why. We live in a world where being a Christian doesn't seem to mean what it once did. And we live in a world that worships power and money, and we feel lost. You are a God of mystery and wonder, and we bring our doubts to you. We confess that all too often we have allowed doubt to overcome faith, and we have turned away when our questions become too hard or too painful. We have preferred easier, smaller imitations of the truth to the life and faith that you desire for us. We have sought refuge in certainty. Forgive us, we pray. Lead us to the heartfelt belief that is unafraid of doubt and that welcomes mystery and that trusts in you. It is in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, that we pray. Together, let us raise our voices in the prayer that he taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
So every Sunday before our offering, we like to talk about the generosity of our church. So this Sunday, we would like to lift up the expansion of our early education program. Our preschool director came to us not too long ago and commented that she had so many kids on the waiting list, she just didn't have a space to put them in. So we started to look around, and we got a little bit creative. And right now in the program, she has about 130 children. And we found space, so we're going to be opening a new room in the fall where we're going to have as much as 20 more kids be able to come here. So some of our confirmands went into that room, and they started to clear it out, and they found some fun things to dress themselves up in. And then they started, not the confirmands, but skilled people of our church started to take down some walls. And the pictures that you see are the construction in progress that's still happening. The hope is that this room will be available in the fall so that we can welcome 20 more kids into this program. So we want to say thank you to everyone who is making this happen. Thank you for your tithes and offerings that go to help this building exist and be what it is. And for the people that actually literally with their hands are building these rooms so that they're safe for more kids to come into our program. So thank you guys for all that you do. Ushers, if you'd like to come forward, and if you will bless our offering.
Let us pray. Generous God, as we gather to offer our tithes and offerings, we are reminded of the words of the Apostle John about the word of life. Just as your word brings light into our lives, may our giving be an act of generosity, a reflection of the abundance of your grace and love. We thank you for the forgiveness and grace offered through your Son, Jesus Christ. And as we give, may we also steward these gifts wisely for the betterment of your kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
My Savior is near, and for my relief will serve. seated.
That are third grade or younger that would like to go to Children's Church during the sermon time, we're going to meet right over here at that door, and then afterwards we will bring the kiddos back. So the kids are going to go and do a lesson on the scripture, so they kind of learn, they get it in their language, basically. So we're Miss Katie's right there, Pastor Katie's right there, so if you're wanting to go to Children's Church, there we go. There are my kiddos running. Okay, awesome. Okay, they're going to go upstairs to the classroom, and then they will be brought back to you after the sermon when the kiddos come in to sing.
Wonderful to have so many young folks this morning. It's so exciting. Our scripture this morning comes from Psalms chapter 19, verses 1 through 6. The heavens declare the glory of God. The skies proclaim the work of his hands. Day after day, they pour forth speech. Night after night, they reveal knowledge. They have no speech. They use no words. No sound is heard from them. Yet their voice goes out into all the earth, their words to the end of the world. In the heavens, God has pitched a tent for the sun. It is like a bridegroom coming out of his chamber, like a champion rejoicing to run his course. It rises at one end of the heavens and makes its circuit to the other. Nothing is deprived of its warmth. This is the word of God for all the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Will you pray with me? Gracious God, we give you thanks for the power of your holy word. We thank you, God, that it speaks life and truth to us. And God, I pray now that either through me or in spite of me, that you might speak your word to your people. And we ask this in the name of Christ our Savior. Amen. My husband proposed to me in May of 2000, and we quickly set our wedding date, January 28, 2001. And you know, the wedding festivity stuff began to be planned. And as part of that process, we began to think about where we wanted to live. My husband, Doug, had a house, a small house. I lived in an apartment, but neither of those places seemed right for us as we began our home together. And one day out of the blue, he said, hey, let's go look at those new houses they're building in Roanoke. And we lived close to Grapevine at the time, and so we hopped in the car, and we headed out there. And we toured a few nice model homes. And the next thing I remember is sitting in an office signing paperwork to buy a new house. And I will tell you, I was in a bit of a panic about this. You see, what you have to know about me is that I'm a planner and an organizer and an analyzer, and I needed to mull it over and think it through. And what I learned was my soon-to-be husband was a pull-the-trigger kind of guy, right? He did not tell me about this. Was not on his questionnaire when he filled it out for me. I didn't know this about him. I had doubts about whether this was a good financial move for us. I didn't know how it was all going to work out. I mean, I hadn't even married this guy, for goodness sake, and I was buying a house with him. It was all kind of too much. But I could have gotten caught in that whole analysis paralysis thing that sometimes I get that happens to me. But instead, I chose to trust. I trusted my soon-to-be husband, who held my hand while I shakily signed all those papers. But really what I trusted was I trusted in God. I trusted more in him than I did in my doubt. And it turned out to be great. It was an awesome place to live. Now, any major decision that you have to make, it is virtually impossible to have complete certainty, isn't it? You know, there's a measure of faith required in almost everything in life. Everybody experiences doubt when it comes to faith at some point in their lives. Doubt is both natural and healthy when it leads us to honest, careful reflection about our faith. Doubt isn't a lack of faith. It's an opportunity to deepen it. Now, over the next few weeks, we're going to explore, we're going to wrestle with doubt and find faith. That's the name of the series that we're in. It's based on a book by a pastor named Adam Hamilton. He pastors a gigantic church in Kansas City, and he did a survey of all the people that go to his church, and they came up with this top six doubts that Christians have, or believers have. And so over the next 6 weeks, we're going to make our way through them and see what we can learn about our own faith as we kind of tackle them. The Bible, though, is full of stories of people who doubted. You don't even have to go very far. Abraham and Sarah. Abraham said yes when God called him, but he and Sarah really struggled with some of the decisions that had to be made as they made their way with God. Jacob wrestled with doubt. When God called Moses, he didn't say, sure, yeah, I'll do that. He said, let me tell you all the reasons, all the excuses and doubts why I'm not the right guy for the job. In the Psalms, David points out his doubts. In the New Testament, Joseph, he doubted Mary when she said, oh, I got pregnant by the Holy Spirit. He's like, yeah, right. Yeah, not so much. Peter doubted when Jesus came walking to him on the water. And Jesus often points out the lack of faith of the disciples. Thomas, he's such a doubter that even today we still call people who have doubts, we call them doubting Thomas, don't we? The biblical people are just like us. They had doubts, and yet God still loved them, and God still used them in mighty ways. Doubt is normal. Faith is a choice that we make. It's a decision every day. We can't be certain. There is no irrefutable evidence of the central claims of Christianity, but there is not any irrefutable claims about any other religion either. There's not even irrefutable proof for atheism that there's no God, right? All of them require a measure of faith. We must review what we can know and make a choice to believe or not to believe. So the question we're tackling today, is there a God? Seems like a pretty good place to start. And so our scripture in Psalm 19 says that the heavens declare the glory of God. The psalmist recognizes God's hand in the natural world. It points to our Creator. Did you hear what he said? He said that the actual natural order of the world pours forth words about God. Most people throughout the world of any religion regard the order, purpose, and beauty of the natural world as evidence of God. That's what the psalmist was trying to express in Psalm 19. Have you ever stood on the beach and watched the sunset? Have you ever been up in the mountains and just saw the beauty of the snow on the top of them? Have you ever marveled at how intricately put together our bodies are? Have you ever watched the moon cover up the sun? Tomorrow you will see that, right? Yeah. Have you ever looked into the eyes of a child full of wonder and excitement about life? I would suggest to you, you've experienced God. God is everywhere in creation. The ways in which all the parts of our world work together are just amazing. Those things didn't happen by chance. They are far too intricate and complicated for that. I don't know how someone can look at all of God's creation and not think to themselves, there had to be a God behind this. Now, I think there are people who conclude that there is no God, even when they look at creation. There's an element of belief about that as well, isn't there? Beauty and the order of nature do not prove conclusively that there is a God. But rather, it is important evidence that lead many to belief in the God of the creation. Now let's talk about something else that gets people in trouble when it talks about faith. Science. There is often a perceived conflict between science and faith. I think this is due to reading the biblical creation stories as if they are scientific accounts rather than symbolic, poetic, and narrative expressions of God's story and God's role as creator. There's two creation stories in the book of Genesis. One at the very beginning that has all the orders, the days where God made things. The second one is a little deeper into Genesis and Genesis 2, and it is the creation of humanity. Now, the biblical creation stories teach us that God is the creator and that God had purpose in creating the world. The first creation story is poetic, signaled by clear structure, repetition, and an emphasis on order and alignment between God's creation and God's spoken words. The second story is narrative. It emphasizes close relationships between humans and the ground and animals and other humans and ultimately with God. Both creation stories reflect an understanding of their writers. To read and evaluate the biblical creation stories on the basis of modern science is to misunderstand their purpose. They are not meant to tell us the how of creation. That's what science can tell us. But rather, they're about the why and the who of creation, which science cannot tell us. Many influential scientists throughout history have been believers in God. People like Isaac Newton and Blaise Pascal and Francis Bacon and Sir Isaac Newton all believed in God. Even George Lemaître, who formulated the Big Bang Theory, did you know he was a Catholic priest? And that he also talks about in his theory that it was God who lit the fuse to begin the bang? Yeah, scientists believe in God. In recent the Pew Center for Research did a poll of all different kinds of scientists from all different fields. Over 51% of them make a claim to believe in God. They can affirm both science and God at the same time. And we can value both science and faith and see them as complementary. Modern science and its conclusions do not disprove God, and faith can enrich one's appreciation for science, even as science and its understanding of nature can deepen our faith. They're not mutually exclusive. So we see God in nature. We can reconcile our belief in science, but I want to suggest to you there's something more persuasive than either one of those things about who God is. I believe that personal experience with God, and people who share that, that's a most powerful thing for people to hear about who God is. I see God in creation, but it is not why I gave my heart and life to Jesus. My faith was shaped by things in my life and ways in which God showed up. I grew up in a church-going family, but we didn't talk about faith very much. I just saw my parents quietly living it out. And so the faith I had as a kid was the faith of my parents. And when I was 13 years old, I got to go through confirmation class at our United Methodist Church in Oklahoma City. And it was there that I began to really fall in love with Jesus. I began reading the Bible for the first time, really for myself. And I had adults around me who could let me ask the hard questions. And they talked to me about it, about faith. I began to pray for the first time, really for myself. That's where I began to kind of create the building blocks of a life of faith. It was in prayer that I felt God really speaking to me about his love for me. And that I had no provision for anything that I did wrong. God was going to love me anyway. I remember going through the actual confirmation in the sanctuary of our church, and I remember our pastor laying his hands on me, and I remember feeling God's presence in a way I'd never felt before. And then I became very active in our youth ministry. I had a great youth minister who poured his life into me, and I learned more about Jesus, and I chose to follow him every day. I wasn't thinking about the Big Bang Theory or the origin of the universe when I came to believe. I was drawn to a God who said, I love you no matter what. We're in this thing together. And every day I wake up, I make a choice to follow Jesus. Now my faith gives me meaning and purpose and joy and hope. And I've experienced acceptance and forgiveness and love And through my faith in Christ, I have come to believe that the painful, difficult, and challenging things in life do not have the final word, and that God can redeem them and bring something good from them. I would be a very different person today if I had never experienced the grace and love of God. I'm guessing as you heard me talk, maybe you thought of times in your own life where you've experienced God. Or maybe you're just sort of trying to figure it all out. But I know that as a church family, I have the pleasure of getting to hear great stories of people who talk about God's presence. Times where they talk about feeling him when the tough decision came to be made. About God's presence as you walked through the pain and grief of loss, of losing someone you love. Lots of stories about things that prayers that have been answered that have no other explanation but God's miraculous work. I've heard about God's reassurance in difficult moments. And as last week we remembered the 12th anniversary of the tornado that came through, this literally came through this church, I heard stories about how God kept everyone safe, including our kids, and about how God's faithfulness helped us see our way through it to rebuild. We have a testimony of God's faithfulness if we're looking. We can bear witness to God's presence. We can join with all creation in proclaiming God's goodness. The trees don't have any words, but we do. Often it's the testimony of others that we put our trust in and our belief in, and that's what leads us to believe in God. I recently read a story that came out of Lisa Beamer's book called Let's Roll. You may remember she lost her husband in the airplane that crashed on 9/11. Here's what she writes. Slowly I began to understand that the plans God has for us don't just include good things, but the whole array of human events. The prospering he talks about in the book of Jeremiah is often the outcome of something we would call a bad event. I remember my mom saying that many people look for miracles, things that in their human minds can fix a difficult situation. Many miracles, however, are not a change to the normal course of human events. They're found in God's ability and desire to sustain and nurture people through even the worst situations. Somewhere along the way, I stopped demanding that God fix the problems in my life and started being thankful for his presence as I endured them. That has been true in my life. God does not give us certainty when it comes to faith. He gives us mystery. And I choose to believe in a God who loves me. A God who loves you too. And a God who came for us in Jesus. And a God who calls us to follow him. If you want to know more about what that looks like in your life, we would love to talk to you about that. Come talk with us. Come see what it means to make a decision every day to follow Jesus. Because here's what I know. It'll change your life forever. Let's pray together. Gracious God, we give you thanks for the power of your word. We thank you for faith and life and truth. Speak to us, God. Move in us. Help us, God, to see your presence in every way. And we ask these things in the name of Christ, our Savior. Amen.
So our kiddos are about to walk in for their spring program. I know that the EEC staff and teachers have been working on this for so long. We appreciate your patience. And I just want to, can we get a big round of applause for the staff and for the teachers here? They're coming on in. So after they sing, they're going to sit down and we're going to do a real quick children's time. And then I'll give you guys more instructions. Come on in, guys.
okay, can y'all have a seat right there? Sit down right there. If I have any other kids that want to come down for children. Oh, there's one more song? Oh, okay, good. They're on the CD. Maybe I should have come to more rehearsals. Okay, I'll sit down now. Now, okay, good job, everybody. Can we get one more big round of applause? All right, y'all have a seat right where you are. Have a seat. If I have any more kiddos that want to come down for children's time, it's going to be fast and furious. I can see that that's what needs to happen. Okay, so guys, y'all know me, right? Miss Alyssa, right, from chapel. I'm so glad to see you guys here. I want to teach y'all, yes, my son, have a seat. I want to teach you guys a prayer real quick, okay? We all need peace, right? Right, everybody? We all need peace. We need peace. So I'm going to teach you guys a prayer that's going to help you pray for peace. Okay, when we have doubts, we can pray for peace. So this is the sign language for peace. I want you to put your hands together. Okay, you're going to twist your hand this way, and then you twist it this way, and then whoosh, hands go down, okay? So in the prayer that we're going to do, we should always thank God for everything that we have. So once you put your hands together like this, and you're going to twist your hand this way, and then when you twist your hand this way, you thank God. So just whenever you're praying, just thank God for everything that God has given you. And then you're going to twist your hands this way, and when you do that, you ask God for what you need. Tell God what you need so God can help you. And then here's the peace part, okay? You're going to whoosh. You're going to give it to God and let God take care of it, okay? So let's practice that real quick. Hands together. Thank you, God. Okay. Please help me with what I need. Whoosh. Give it to God. All right, so now we're going to say one big prayer together, all right? Okay, here we go. Hands together. Dear God, thank you for loving me no matter what. Now twist your hands. Help me to always be that love in the world. And in your son's name we pray. Whoosh. Amen. Good job, guys. Okay. Now what you guys are going to do, your teachers are going to take you back to your classroom. We are going to finish service. We have one more song, and then we're going to finish service, and your parents are going to pick you up in the classroom, and then there are cookies and punch in the gym, okay? All right? So you guys go back with your teachers, and your parents will be there in about 5 minutes, okay? All right. Good job, everybody. Good job. Yay. Oh, yeah, y'all stay to...
All right, as they make their way back to the classrooms, you guys hang tight, we'll be done in just a moment. I want to remind us of a couple of points that Kissa made in her sermon today. One is that doubt is not the lack of faith, but it's an opportunity to deepen our own understanding, and that each day we get to choose to serve and to follow Jesus Christ. I would like to invite all of you to rise as we close out our service with our final hymn, Jesus Shall Reign.
And we need all the blessings we can get, right? So we receive it with our head up and our eyes open. So go forth into the world and love God and your neighbor in all that you do. And bear witness to the love of Christ in this life, so that those who haven't yet known it might find within you a warm and a generous friend. And may the love of God and the peace of Christ and the communion of God's Holy Spirit be with us today, tomorrow, and forevermore. Amen.